Can I ask you to please rise for the family coming in?
Grace sound that saved a wretch like me.
Welcome you this morning and this afternoon and our time together for the family. Thank you for friends and family who have come today to honor Willie Colson and loved by many, many relationships. And to the family, I want to say I'm just deeply sorry for what has gone on and with his life. And I know that he'll be sadly missed by you, that we're going to be having people from the family, friends, to be able to share about various memories of his life. And so you're able to partake in that together, and that's a wonderful thing. Thank you for everybody that is here. And I'd like to invite Stacy Inslee, Buddy's niece, to come forward at this time, and she's going to be sharing some memories and also a reading from Psalm 23. Thank you, Tracy.
I'm actually Tracy. I'm one of the twins.
Okay.
Right. So, no, it's fine.
Which twin? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. This afternoon, I just wanted to talk a little bit as I reflect on my Uncle Buddy. I'm sure as I look back on the days and the years from now, I'm sure I'll remember the last 2 months of him. When he was in the hospital, it touched my heart. I will especially remember the last 2 weeks, how it was tough on him. He was very sick. I don't even think he knew how sick he was. But that is not how he would want us to remember him. When he came home, those 3 days that he came home, my mom called me on a Tuesday. She said, "You've got to go get him a recliner chair. He wants one of those lift chairs." And I said, okay. So Christy and I went to Sawyer's House of Furniture and we picked out a chair, a nice brown one. We picked it out and Daddy came and picked it up, hauled it up in the back of the truck, got home. Before we could get home, Daddy already had it in his house. So Mom and Dad loaded it up, put it all in the house. And that night when I went over there to see Buddy, he got to sit in that chair for 40 minutes. And I talked him into it. I said, well, Christy, Derek, and I were like, well, let's go back to the hospital. I think it's time. Let's go make sure everything's right. Let's go back and get stronger. So we did. We took him back that night. So I'm pretty sure that's not how he would want us to remember him. I'm going to tell you how he would want us to remember him. Let's remember him for his 71 years of happiness and good health. He looked great. He was doing really well. He was able to get in his car. He could drive. He was happy. He was able to go to church. He was able to visit people. He was able to go across the ditch and go see Daddy, walk around his yard. He did his own mowing the grass. He got to go down to the shop and see Derek. He got to go out to dinner. He talked on the phone. He got to work. He worked up until the very end. He was sitting in that trucker seat. I'm pretty sure he saw more sunrises and more sunsets than most of us put together. He lived very happy. He did all the things that made him very happy, and that's what he would want us to remember. But I have two special memories of him when I was a little girl. I was about 11 years old. One summer, I decided I was going to go trucking. So I got up early one morning, and I packed us hot dogs on loaf bread with some hot dogs and mustard. We were real fancy. So I climbed up in the truck and I rode with him. I'd ride. When I got tired, I would climb in the back in the sleeper. I would zip it up. That was the best sleep I'd ever had. While he stayed driving and working, I'd get up while it was time to unload or load. I'd get in the front, in the passenger seat. And when it was lunchtime, I would pass him his hot dog and I would eat my hot dog. I remember those days. That was my short trucking experience, but I had a good time. And then there was another one. I would go over there on some of the afternoons on Saturdays while he was cleaning out the truck, washing the truck up, getting it ready for the week. Well, one Saturday, I was in the driver's seat. I was helping him clean it up. He got in on the passenger seat, and he said, "Hey, I want you to pull that truck up some." I was like, "No, I'm not going to do that." He's like, "Yeah, yeah." So he said, "Well, put your foot on the gas and turn it this way." Well, I turned the way he told me, and I think he got a little mixed up sitting on the passenger side, and I sideswiped the brown, the gray, black, I think it was gray, the little pickup truck. And he starts saying, "Whoa, whoa, whoa." I jumped out of the truck, and I was crying. I was all upset. But it wasn't funny then, but it's funny now that we had a little fender bender in the driveway. So those were my two things that I would remember about him. But that's the way he would want us to remember him. One, for everyday things that he did for you all. Remember him when he was in the yard, when he would pull up in the truck and the kids would honk the horn, and he would honk the horn every time. Remember him when he went to church and he enjoyed getting out and about. And when you all called him, he always answered the phone. That's what he would want us to remember. Remember those stories and remember the funny times and the good times that you had with him. That's what he wants. But when I think of him, I think of him as the hardworking man that he was. I think of him as the good, caring man that he was. I'll always remember his smile, and when he asked what you were doing, he genuinely cared about what you were doing. And he was never too busy to stop and talk to you. I'm going to miss him walking to the mailbox when he got home from work, and I would see him as I was walking down the road. Those are the things. But in the days ahead, I know it may be hard for some of us, but let's remember the happiness that he had. He was a loving father. He was a great uncle, great brother, and he was a friend to all. But he may not be sitting in that new chair that he has. He may not be sitting in that trucker seat, but he's got the best seat in the whole house. He's sitting in heaven, and he's watching, and he's smiling down on us, and he's happy, and he is still watching all the sunrises and the sunsets. I love you, buddy. We love you too, all of us. I'm going to ask you all to pray. Bow your head. Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
That was beautiful, wasn't it? Boy, a lot of you identified with that. In that, my experience with Willie has been when he was in the hospital and where he was not feeling well. But he was a good man, saw in his life, even though we had only had a short acquaintance. So I'd like to share some remembrances from people from the family. The first one, Susie Colson, that's Buddy's sister-in-law, and written by her, but to be an encouragement to us today. From Susie Colson, I became a family member of Buddy's life when I married his younger brother, Wayne. Buddy was called Cool. He had three different names, right? Willie, Buddy, and Cool, right? Wow, I only have one. I mean, I'll go there. And Wayne was called Wooly Bully. I have no idea what that means, but you know, you got, how many know what it means? I don't know. Okay, very good. I'll hear from you later, okay? That'll be good. I know where not to try, not to pass, so okay, you know, that's good. But his Wayne was called Wooly Bully. Wooly Bully is not here now to give his own memory, so I will do this for his memory for him. Cool. Thank you for the days spent with me out in the shop talking about everything from the loads you hauled that week for J.W. Jones or the loads you had to haul in the next week. Thank you for being Uncle Cool. Boy, I like that name. That's great. I'm going to have to tell my family about that. Say, you know, cool, man, cool. But just K-E-W-L, not C-O-O-L. Thank you for being Uncle Cool to my four sons and a great Uncle Cool to my grandchildren and a great big brother to me. Rest in peace, Cool. Beautiful. Thank you from Susie. And also his nephew, which is Buddy Colson there. That's Derek, Buddy's nephew. Best memories I have of Uncle Cool are following one another going to or from the same place in the truck. He didn't mind helping anyone out and didn't expect anything in return. He always would call and ask how Chase, Nicholas, Stella, and Tucker was doing. I know he didn't have any grandkids, but his face would light up about my kids. Earlier that year, he came up to the shop and I had a cookie brownie with him and had to make sure he gave it to Stella. Nicholas would always tell me if he was outside and saw that red Mack go by. He would let us all know Uncle Cool was going home. Nicholas also would let me know he talked with Uncle Cool or Papa's phone and tell him to lighten up. Lighten up. Tell him, you know what he's talking about? Lighten up? Okay, all right. Well, I don't know what that means, but sounds good. I know Tucker enjoyed being around him, and Uncle Cool always made a point to see him. I know you and Wooly Billy are up there having a good time, probably sitting around enjoying the time and talking about old times. I'll keep trucking it up there until we all meet again. Gonna miss you, Uncle Cool. Oh. And then from Chase, that's Derek's son. The best memories I have of Uncle Cool are that he would always come to the shop all the time and hang out with Pawpaw. He would always let me sit in the red Mack whenever I wanted to. I really miss Pawpaw, and now I'm going to miss Uncle Cool. I hope Pawpaw and Uncle Cool are seeing each other in heaven and watching over Nicholas, Stella, Tucker, and I. We are going to miss you, Uncle Cool. Please give Pawpaw a big hug for me. I love you, Uncle Cool. Well, thank you for those that share. That's wrote those memories out. That's a beautiful memory. At this time, we're going to have a couple songs right now that they're going to play, Scars in Heaven, and then What a Day That Will Be by Jim Hill, and enjoy.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing,
And they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made. Thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven on the hands that hold you now.
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes
no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no more pain, no more parting over there. Glorious day that will be.
say amen. I'll say it again. Impress me. Thank you. Very good. God bless you all. I love the songs. Thank you for the family that brought those beautiful songs forward and the memories that you have shared. They're just so appropriate for today. And saying goodbye to somebody that we love very much. Over the years, decades now, I can't believe it, I'm 68, but I feel like I'm 30. Then about 9 o'clock at night, I feel like I'm 90. I'm like, you know, what happened today? But nevertheless, over those decades and everything, I've been a pastor for a long time, various places. I've had the privilege of being with many people on their deathbed. And it has been a privilege. Sounds kind of weird, doesn't it? You know, saying goodbye, they're saying the family, of course, are sad. I don't particularly like that part of it. Nevertheless, it's been always a privilege, and that I've always been stunned by one thing in their lives, what's going on. When I was with the people, and this is without exception over decades now, I can now say at 68, this is decades. It's not just last week or the week before. No one on their deathbed, when they know they're going to pass, no one talks to me about their 401ks. They don't talk to me, oh yeah, I have this huge house and summer home and beach home and all the rest. And boy, yeah, my Lexus, man, that's really good. Oh, my Lexus, yes, I bought it a few years ago, you know, whatever. Nobody, which is so stunning to me, ever talks to me about those things on the deathbed. They have family around you, hopefully their family's there and friends. And there's two things that everyone talks to me about. What I hear, they talk to their family and everything like this. It's two things. What's the quality of the relationships in their families or friends? Usually that comes with some regrets. You know, I wish I did this, or my son was with me and we've been estranged from our daughter-in-law and all the rest of it that's going on. And then they talk about, of course, what's going to happen when I breathe my last. That's the part that you just might as well put a bone in front of a dog, because said, I'm glad I'm there, because I'm able to share with them that as they pass over to an eternity, before they pass eternity, that they can have confidence. Can you say the word confidence? Confidence. That passing over, even though we're not sure about all that happens, because God knows everything, that they can have a confidence that passing over, they can see Jesus, and they could know God intimately. And all the things that we think are so important for our lives, yeah, we need to work, yeah, we need to have money, we need to have a house, we have a car, whatever's going on. But in the final analysis is that does not matter at all when you pass over. How many can say amen to that? Amen. It doesn't matter. There is no U-Haul that is parking up to Twyford Funeral Home anytime when there's a funeral. There's nothing. You're not taking anything there. What happens is, the Apostle Paul said for us very clearly, he said, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Something happens, and the time of death, when the physical body ceases to exist, in some way, God does something where the spirit, which is really who all of us are, our spirit that God has put into us, that is somehow taken away and goes to be in the presence of God. Everything else that can so enamor us in life, and we need this, we want to do that and everything, the final analysis that over all of these decades of being with people that have died, nobody talks to me about those things. They're not talking to their family about them. They want to know, I wish my son was here, my daughter was here, my estranged wife was here. Those are things that are important. So in our lives, every time, and I'm always challenged whenever I hear it, honestly, personally, I am personally challenged. Say, Lord, help me every day to live for what is really important, for what is really going to matter, all right? Does it mean you go off and be a monk someplace in some austere monastery? No, absolutely, but living in this world, but not being of this world. For the Christian, the real life happens on the other side, and it happens for eternity. We're just a short time, 60, 70, 80, 90 years, 100 years, whatever it is, and longevity, okay? But the question is, what are we living for in here? And I am personally challenged every time when I'm with somebody in that situation. Contrary to common belief and thing that the Bible does not teach a universal salvation, Jesus said these really clear words, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He offers his love, his care. Right now at this time, especially for you as family, God is reaching out to you with his great love and his care for you because you feel a void in your heart. And I know I've experienced that in my own life many, many times of relatives and friends that have passed away. And I can tell you for sure, you open your heart up to God and say, God, I need you in my life. God does not turn a deaf ear to that. He hears the cry of even our heart that no one else can see. But he sounds indeed, yes, he come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Building our lives on shifting values changes. It doesn't happen. It doesn't keep us going. It may feel good for a while. Yeah, it's good to be successful. Be successful if you can, but be more successful in your relationship with God. Because eventually, this world, you're leaving it. And we're going to have a service for you. We're going to say goodbye and with tears in our lives. But then you look and say, then you're going to be going and meeting the creator and lover of your soul. And what you do with him on this side affects where you're going to go on the other side. And to be right with God is so important. And there, a test of who you are in our lives, let's face it. Hey, listen, when we go through challenging times like we're facing today in the family, and you know, that becomes a litmus test as to where we are in our lives. What is valuable to us? What is going on in my life? Where am I going? Am I missing something, everything? And as I said, every time, a lot of times, you know, God challenges me to say, Lord, Mike, are you going to follow me no matter what? What you told me like 25 years ago that you would do? Well, what is heaven like? Heaven is wonderful. It is something we can say all those, but let me tell you what the Bible says about it, which is really so good. Like, it's like, I want to get there. I want to be there. When I read this from Revelation 21, the last book of the Bible, it says, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Every tear. It's not going to be crying. Funeral homes have to get another business. Doctors have to go to another profession. All those that are wonderful people, they help us. It's great to be here. But in heaven, there's no death. There's no dying. God never intended for us to go through funeral services in the beginning, in Genesis. But because of sin, it was brought into our lives. But in the final analysis, it is all wiped away. There will be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. And I don't know about you, that sounds very good to me. That's right. Not that I'm looking to go like tomorrow and, you know, there, but hey, listen, you know, between now and when we are transformed into that, of going there, that's a great thing to look for. Say, God, I thank you, Lord, for being released from these things that have caused us to have grief and loss in our lives.
And Jesus said these, "My Father's house has many rooms. If were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come back and take you with me, and that you may be where I am." Some place in Willie's life, some place, he encountered Jesus. Some place in his life, the juncture, I'm not sure about it was, but we talked and shared the short times that we actually met, but some place he said yes to Jesus in his life. Talking religion? Absolutely not. I'm not into religion. I don't believe religion is true. I'm talking about relationship. Heart-to-heart relationship, where here it's God and me, we're heart-to-heart, we are with each other, I'm going his way because his way is always the best. Can you say amen? Amen. Oh, that's a little weak. Can you say that God's way is always best? Say amen.
Amen.
Oh, good, you're sounding Pentecostal. We're going to open up in just a little bit. Come on, help me feel good here, man. I'm from Fountain of Life, okay? I want you to know it. But in that, yeah, and but encountering Christ gives hope that we're not just living out our daily life and going to work and taking care of the kids and all the rest of the stuff that goes in. It says that there's a future hope. This is what the Bible says. Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for him who loves him. And when you reach out and respond to the love of God in your life, there's a transformation inside of you where you look and say, yeah, you go through hard things like the passing of Willie, passing of other people, challenges. You never look for financial reversals, all right, but you know that in your heart say, yeah, this is hard, so I'm going, but you know God is going to take me through this. And when you know the strength of God in the time of weakness, there's nothing like it. You feel the wind on your back, but say, God, you're taking me through. And you know that he's there. And you've let him come into your heart and life. Wow, you can face anything. Because you know he's not just there, he's in here. He's down deep in the soul. And say, God, it's you and me, and we're going to get through this together. Paul wrote this. He said, "Nothing will separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." He was one that went through so many things. Paul, you can read about him in the Bible, went through so much. But nothing will separate you from the love of God in Jesus Christ. To have that confidence and being convinced in your heart that he is with you allows you to go through very difficult things, but you know that he's always there and he's always willing to listen. You see, you're my friends now, so I love you. Because I know that God loves you. I may not know you by name, God knows everybody's name, doesn't he? He cares about every person here today. He loves you with an everlasting love. That's what the Bible says. Everything, including the hairs on your head, or lack of them. Hey, he has every one of them numbered. He knows exactly what's going on. He knows what you're facing. He knows what's happening, even if somebody else knows. Because he looks in our hearts. I can't look in anybody's heart. God lives in your heart, and he loves you, and he cares for you. And, said like this in the book of Isaiah about Jesus, that he took upon himself, that's Jesus, all of our sin, all of our sorrows, all the challenge you face. But this is the part that's so excellent. And by his stripes, or say wounds, that's Jesus on the cross, wounded, beaten, bruised. You've seen the movies about it. By his wounds, we are healed. So I can say equivocally to every person in this family, and the loving people that are over here,
is that he is the healer of hearts. Jesus took upon all of our sin and all of our sickness, all of our sorrows. He didn't leave one of them out. And by his wounds on the cross, we are healed. Every person here, I wish I could say it in such a way that it penetrates your heart, that he knows everything that's going on, and he is the healer of your life. Yes, he heals our sicknesses to us. You can go out and heal people. It's like, wow, excellent. But you know, you can have a sickness go on. You can get over it in the next few days. But the matters of the heart, they need to be healed also, don't they? Our hearts. The loss that you won't see with. On the other side, you can see. But the healing of our heart is often greater necessity than even the healing of our bodies. So we have Jesus offering, you can picture his hands, nailed, bruised, broken for us, but on the same time, 3 days later, resurrected, new body, all there, and sitting at the hand of God. And he offers to every one of us here today, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Peace in your heart. You have the good memories, sometimes you'll cry, but when you have the rest of God and the love of God in your heart, that God, you're going to take me through this also. I'm going to ask if you're okay for just to bow your heads and close your eyes, won't you, just for a moment. I'm not going to draw it out or anything. But it's so attentive. I'm trying to sense your love, too, for this family. But I'd like to ask you, just with every head bowed and eyes closed, if you have any question about that if you die today or tomorrow or the next day, whether you go to heaven, let's settle it now. Give you an opportunity. Very clear, very simple. I'm a sinner. How many agree that they're a sinner? Just say amen. Okay, I'm the only sinner here then. But God offers to us forgiveness. God forgives sin. And when we allow him to do that, he makes us new men and women. I'm going to ask you to pray right now. Won't you, just from your heart, talking to God because he hears you. Would you repeat these words? Heavenly Father, thank you for your love.
Thank you for your
Son,
the Lord Jesus Christ,
who died on the cross
for me.
I agree with you. I'm a sinner.
I ask you, forgive me
of all of my sin. Come into my life
and make me a new person.
I give
my life
to you.
Thank you for your love.
That is great.
In the name of Jesus, I pray.
Amen.
I'm going to ask you, please, on this side, to stand up, please, won't you? I'm going to ask you, please, if you don't mind the family sitting down. We want to pray for you right now. Is that okay with you? I'm not going to ask you to do anything weird. We're going to pray. I'm going to ask you to just lift a hand towards this family here. Why don't you just lift a hand? And we're going to pray for them right now. How many are okay with that? Just pray for them. Let's pray for them right now. Let me bow your heads and we're just going to pray for you. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the men and women, young people, children here, that you are great, that your love is great. We pray, Lord, that they would sense the love of God enfolding around them, that they would know that you have never left them. And we thank you for your love that is healing, that is kind, that reaches out to us even right now. For nothing will separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thank you for your care for every person.
And we give you all the thanks for how great you are. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen. 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 God bless you very much. Ask you all to stand, please.